confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Dearly beloved brethren, the scripture moveth us in sundry places to acknowledge and confess our manifold sins and wickedness, and that we should not dissemble or cloak them before the face of Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, but confess them with a humble, lowly, penitent, and obedient heart, to the end that we may obtain forgiveness of the same by his infinite goodness and mercy. And although we ought at all times humbly to acknowledge our sins before God, yet ought we most chiefly so to do when we assemble and meet together to render thanks for the great benefits that we have received at his hands, to set forth his most worthy praise, to hear his most holy word, and to ask those things which are requisite and necessary as well for the body as the soul. Wherefore I pray and beseech you, as many as are here present, to accompany me with a pure heart and humble voice unto the throne of the heavenly grace, saying after me.
Amen. transcribe Paul's letter to Romans. For the promise that he should be the heir of the world was not to Abraham or to his seed through the law, but through the righteousness of faith. For if they which are of the law be heirs, faith is made void, and the promise made of none effect, because the law worketh wrath, for where no law is, there is no transgression. Therefore it is of faith that it might be by grace, to the end the promise might be sure to all the seed, not to that only which is of the law, but that also which is of the faith of Abraham, who is the father of us all. As it is written, I have made thee a father of many nations, before him whom he believed, even God, who quickeneth the dead, and calleth those things which be not as though they were, who against hope believed in hope, that he might become the father of many nations, according to that which was spoken, so shall thy seed be. Here ends the lesson.
Thank you.
The child Jesus tarried behind in Jerusalem, and Jesus and his mother knew not of it. But they, supposing him to have been in the company, went a day's journey, and they sought him among their kinsfolk and acquaintance. And when they found him not, they turned back again to Jerusalem, seeking him. And it came to pass that after 3 days they found him in the temple, sitting in the midst of the doctors, both hearing them and asking them questions. And all that heard him were astonished at his understanding and answers. And when they saw him, they were amazed. And his mother said unto him, Son, why hast thou thus dealt with us? Behold, thy father and I have sought thee sorrowing. And he said unto them, How is it that ye sought me? Wist ye not that I must be about my father's business? And they understood not the saying which he spake unto them. And he went down with them and came to Nazareth, and was subject unto them. But his mother kept all these sayings in her heart. And Jesus increased in wisdom and stature, and in favor with God and man. Here ends the lesson.
Thank you.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven, and sits on the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, the life everlasting. Amen.
Oh, Joe's effort, since I seldom refuse a challenge, that's what I'm going to do. It is a challenge, though, because although we see him every Christmas standing slightly off to the side in the manger scene, the Bible tells us so much less about Joseph than it does about the rest of the dramatis personae of that scene. And we have to dig a little bit deeper if we are to give him his rightful place in God's Word and be able to hear God's voice speaking to us in what Scripture says about him. The word Joseph is actually Hebrew for Jehovah has added. And it first appears in Scripture as the name given by Rachel to the child that she finally bore after years of waiting and years of watching her rival and her sister Leah have one son after another. God hearkened to her and opened her womb, the narrator of Genesis tells us. She conceived and bore a son and said, God has taken away my reproach. And she called his name Joseph, saying, may the Lord add to me another son. She called his name Jehovah has added, saying, may the Lord add to me another son. So the name came to being right in the middle of the world that we live in today. No sooner was Joseph named with thanksgiving and celebration, Jehovah has added, than more is demanded. Add to me another son. Genesis even puts those in the same sentence. And even after 3,000 years of human beings becoming daily more superior in every imaginable way, as they tell me, you may be familiar with that attitude. You may even have had moments like that yourself. But through the Joseph named with such ambiguous sentiments, God brought salvation to his whole family. You remember how young Joseph was sold into slavery by his jealous brothers. And instead of yielding to his fate and living like a slave, or rebelling against it with such fury that he died of the inevitable punishments, Joseph made himself useful and rose to become the de facto governor of the most powerful nation of the day. God gave him a new name, Israel, but he remained still so much part of the family in his own mind that when he was finally reconciled with his brothers, he made the promise that he would be buried in the place where he would have been if his descendants had never been taken into captivity. And he was, but not until generations later. His family's descendants fell back into slavery in Egypt, but when God finally delivered them and they escaped from Egypt and returned to the promised land, they took Joseph's body with them, and Moses ordered it finally buried in its proper place. And Moses pronounced this blessing on his descendants. Blessed by the Lord be his land, the choicest gifts of heaven above. Let these come upon the head of Joseph and upon the crown of the head of him that is prince among his brothers. When his descendants formed themselves into a new nation in the promised land, they often referred to themselves as the sons of Joseph. This first Joseph was a foreshadowing of the one far down the generations who would bring salvation not from earthly depredations, but from spiritual ones, from the covetousness, the prize, add to me another in the midst of the blessings poured out on us already, and all the other spiritual failings that still beset us. Lots of people were named after Joseph over the centuries. You can read half a dozen of them probably in the Old Testament. But many of his descendants did not live by the faith handed down to them and did not take seriously their promises to live in accordance with the Lord's will. But the Lord never abandoned them, never ceased to call them back to him through the prophets he sent to them. Hate evil, love good, establish justice, and it may be that the Lord will be gracious to the remnant of Joseph, was the burden of the message they brought from God. The first Joseph was the son of Jacob, and when the time finally came for God to redeem his wayward and sinful people, Matthew tells us that he used another Joseph and the son of another Jacob. And that's the quiet figure in the manger scene. Despite the massive legends that accumulated around him during the Middle Ages, we know a lot less about him than about the first Joseph, who gets about 20 chapters to himself in the book of Genesis. We presume he was born in Bethlehem, because when Caesar Augustus ordered a census to be taken, everyone had to go back to the town where he was born in order to participate in it, and Joseph went to Bethlehem. We may also presume that his whole family had moved away years earlier, because when he went, he had no friends or relatives there with whom he could stay. The first thing we don't actually have to guess at is that he was a righteous man, because Matthew tells us that explicitly. And we can see for ourselves that this is true by his response when he found out that his fiancée was pregnant. Knowing it could not be his child, he was nevertheless unwilling to put her to shame and resolved to divorce her quietly. Because he was a righteous man, he decided to obey the spirit of the law given in the Old Testament and cancelled the marriage. But because he was also compassionate and kind, he planned to do so without fuss, just an announcement that it was best for all if the marriage did not take place, no reasons given. To have done otherwise would have meant dreadful punishment for Mary. Joseph's righteousness made him obey the spirit of the law. His mercy made him reluctant to insist on the letter of it. Another foreshadowing, this time of Jesus' sacrifice of himself for the sake of others, in which mercy and justice are both fulfilled completely. But while Joseph was still considering his response, God sent an angel to show Joseph the truth. Do not fear to take Mary, your wife, for that which is conceived in her is of the Holy Spirit. She will bear a son, and you shall call his name Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins. And Joseph, again, we can presume, happily obeyed. Happy to believe something that he couldn't really wrap his mind around, partly because he loves Mary, but also because he loves God. A husband who loves his wife is only halfway there. It takes love of God as well to be a good husband, although we all need a great deal of growth in both these loves, as every wife will testify, although a merciful wife, I've noticed, changes the subject when she's asked. Joseph did not appear to have thought very deeply about the angel's words. He was happy to have his difficulty resolved. Unlike Mary, who treasured these things in her heart, and in the incident some years later that we heard about in the reading today, both Mary and Joseph were amazed at what Jesus told them, but only Mary is described as continuing to think about these things. Joseph was just good, like all men are, of just putting those kinds of difficult things out of his mind and getting on with the business of providing for his family. When he and Mary took the baby to the temple in Jerusalem to present the baby to the Lord, as was the custom for the firstborn male, Joseph was amazed when someone in the temple, just a bystander really, an old man, looked at the little baby and began to pray, saying more or less, "Lord, now you are letting me die in peace, because with my own eyes I've seen the salvation. salvation which you have prepared for the whole world, a light for revelation to the Gentiles and for glory to your people, Israel. And seeing the baby, Simeon has seen his Savior. Simeon was also led by the Holy Spirit to reveal some painful things that lay ahead for the baby, but he said those things to Mary only. Joseph was the practical type and had probably already started to get on with something else that he knew needed to be done. Soon the angel came back to Joseph and said, "Take the child and his mother and flee to Egypt and remain there till I tell you. Herod is about to search for the child to destroy him." God's guidance and Joseph's willingness to be guided saved the infant Jesus from death before he could carry out God's plan for the salvation of the world. If he had died then, there would have been nobody to carry the message of his saving death out into the world. He needed to train those apostles first. So he needed to be rescued from that early death. Joseph's willingness was an impressive one, a journey of several weeks into an unknown land where he had no support from friends or family, and where he had to stay for probably quite some time until he could be sure that the danger was past. And after the incident that we heard, where Jesus stayed behind to chat to the teachers in the temple, we really hear almost nothing of Joseph. He was said by the inhabitants of Nazareth to have been a carpenter, although the Greek word used there usually means builder. But Justin Martyr, who was born in Palestine and lived there around 100 years later, he believed that the word meant carpenter and said that he actually had seen plows and ox yokes still in use, said to have been made in the carpenter shop at Nazareth during Joseph's lifetime. That Joseph was a good father, we can also presume, because Luke tells us that Jesus was obedient to him. And since we're also told that Jesus was without sin, Joseph must never have told Jesus to do anything that wasn't honest and upright. And it may be due to Joseph that Jesus just simply couldn't imagine a father who, if his son asks for a fish, would instead of a fish, give him a serpent. In some of the incidents of Jesus' adult life, his father is not named when the rest of the family is referred to. There's no mention of Joseph at the crucifixion or afterwards, although Mary is mentioned often there, which leads most scholars to conclude that Joseph must have died some years earlier, leaving Mary a widow. Jesus, when about to die on the cross, entrusted his mother to John's care, which he would have been unlikely to do if her husband was still alive. All in all, we can say that there is not a lot about this distant descendant of the first Joseph in the Bible, yet what God did through the first Joseph foreshadowed what God would do through the second, bringing salvation to his people from the consequence of their sins. And I, for one, at least feel that it's nice to know that down-to-earth men who tend to feel a little out of their depth when spiritual issues are at the top of the agenda can still serve God just by being faithful to the task God has given, by being a good husband and a good father, even when by ordinary standards it's not an easy thing to do. By sticking to the task set before him, by doing what God asked, even when it wasn't easy or convenient, Joseph became a part of something bigger than he may ever have understood during his earthly life. And there isn't one of us who can't do as much as Joseph. To keep the faith even when we're not quite sure where it's taking us. To be the best we can for God. To follow faithfully the path set before us, journeying with God and trusting Him for the destination. And I pray that this reminder of what great things God can do with small acts of faithfulness will encourage every one of us to a greater persistence in our own faith. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Bringing that message to us, and I want to acknowledge this really exciting. translated for the first time, evening service by Dr. Stout. Service was commissioned by St. Andrew's Friends of Music in loving memory of Mary Louise McTague Egan, mother of St. Andrew's choir members, Kathy Egan and Mary Mount Luley, and certainly a gift for us indeed. Please note the flyer that's inserted in the leaflet this afternoon showing Holy Week and Easter services at St. Andrew's. Evensong in April on Thursday and Easter week, April 4th. Recital afterwards with Tom Octave and students from St. Vincent's College in La Trobe. And on the third Sunday of the month at 4:30, April 21st, our guest preacher will be Heather Vacek. She is the new assistant professor of church history at Pittsburgh Theological Seminary and is an ordained minister in the Moravian Church of America. So looking forward to welcoming her next month. The Lord be with you. Lord, our governor, whose glory is in all the world, we commend this nation to thy merciful care, that being guided by thy providence, we may dwell secure in thy peace. Grant to the President of the United States, the governor of this commonwealth, and to all in authority, wisdom and strength to know and to do thy will. Fill them with the love of truth and righteousness, make them ever mindful of their calling to serve this people thy fear. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who liveth and reigneth with thee and the Holy Ghost, one God, world without end. Amen. Amen. Everlasting God, who alone workest great marvels, send down upon our bishops and curates of all congregations committed to their charge the healthful spirit of thy grace, and that they may truly please thee pour upon them the continual dew of thy blessing. Grant this, O Lord, for the honor of our advocate and mediator, Jesus Christ.
Amen.
God has given us grace at this time with one accord to make our common supplications unto thee. Just promise that when two or three are gathered together in thy name, thou wilt grant their requests. Fulfill now, O Lord, the desires and petitions of thy servants, as may be most expedient for them. Granting us in this world knowledge of thy truth, and in the world to come, life everlasting. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, the fellowship of the Holy Ghost be with us all.